action for the Grammy party.
Oh.
And we're going again. I'm Matt.
Hi, I'm Rose.
And we're going to be looking at some scripts. What do you feel like looking at, Rose?
Oh, let's see what we got here.
What's your favorite genre to read?
I like comedy and I like horror because I feel like those are my favorite to watch as well.
I like horror better than comedy because there's nothing worse than when a comedy isn't funny.
Yeah. Horror is either going to be creepy and good or it's going to be funny because it's so bad. So it's kind of a win-win.
Okay, we got TV. World War Uber, comedy drama, 28 pages. Okay. We got The Disassociation Effect, mystery, 19 pages. Feature, Eyes on Fire, thriller, 98.
That sounds kind of intriguing.
Kind of calling my name.
Yeah, same. Can I turn this lamp off so it's not shining on the screen? Because I feel like it's going to be hard to read the...
Sure.
Yeah. Or do you think it's going to make it really dark in here?
You hated that lamp.
Is it too dark?
I think we're okay. When a seasoned firefighter plays detective to catch a serial arsonist, he investigates a childhood friend and his cancer-stricken partner.
Okay.
That fills me with dread.
That's a lot. That's a lot. Just front-loading it right there.
Why does that fill me with dread? I guess that suggests the movie that to me that suggests the movie where there's two scenes. Oh no, a fire is going on.
I guess that suggests the movie.
Wow.
Are we actually live right now?
Yeah, we actually are.
Okay.
But nobody's watching, so that's even better. Yay, we could do anything.
No stakes.
Yeah. You know what? I hate the establishment because I'm risky like that.
Yeah.
To me, it's the reason why I'm not super wild about this log line is it suggests two scenes in the second act. I'm investigating you, childhood friend. I'm investigating you, cancer-ridden partner.
I mean, I feel like the childhood friend part could be like some shit went down with them and it's like payback. Like I'm gonna light all the stuff on fire. I don't know. But the cancer-ridden partner, I don't know. I guess I am kind of interested. It just seems so strange that I'm like, I want to see how this all ties together, but I don't know. Eyes on fire.
All right. The first thing that occurs to me is that it's a double meaning because her eyes were on fire, but her eyes were on the fire because she's a firefighter.
Right.
By people.
Oh, was it a female firefighter?
No, I was just pitching it based on you. Alright. Over black. A phone rings. A dispatch woman, 50s, answers.
911, what's your emergency?
I just love the sound. The siren, the soundtrack to my masterpieces.
That was a good band. Hello, sir? Sir?
Street lights in soft focus and, as a breeze whips the falling snow flurries into a chaotic dance.
Tell me something. Do you find beauty in destruction?
Exterior, abandoned house tonight. A house ablaze. In the foreground, the shadowy figure stands watching. Cell phone at his ear. Dispatch. Sir, what's your emergency?
I do. There's such an awe-inspiring potential in it. You burn something to ashes and just about anything can rise from them.
Sir, we're tracing the location of this call. Please stay on the line until our first responders arrive.
The man stands and admires the fire for another long moment. Sirens in the distance finally catch his attention.
Sounds like they're already here, but they're too late.
He looks down at his phone, pulls a small distortion box off the bottom, chucks the phone into the fire, and walks away.
Basically, which I ended up figured out is like it, this goes faster if you read like you know your life is on it. Like oh no, I gotta get this.
Okay.
We hang on the burning house, sirens getting ever closer.
After a long moment, two fire trucks arrive at the scene.
Avery, mid-40s, is the first one out of the lead truck. He's in a white fire chief shirt, starts barking orders before his feet hit the ground. Okay, you assholes, you know the drill. No reports of any life inside, so just point this wet shit at the hot shit until it's all gone. Let's move!
Firefighters swarm the scene in full gear. They shout over each other unintelligibly, their own language.
Hoses get unwound, a nearby hydrant gets unscrewed, hose secured to it.
The hoses go live and douse the flames upstairs.
A second hose gets hooked up and focuses on the downstairs fire. Avery surveys the scene, trusts his men enough not to get too involved. This is routine and almost boring for him.
He paces back and forth near one of the trucks.
Good job, ladies! At this rate, we might break the house record!
Movement in one of the upstairs windows catches his attention.
Whoa! Ease up.
Everything comes to a screeching halt. Hoses off.
Avery focuses in, sees the outline of a person silhouetted in the orange glow.
Chief, there's somebody inside!
Yeah, I noticed that.
Avery looks into the flaming house. No time for confusion.
Ladders up, boys. We're going in.
A pair of firefighters carry a ladder towards the house, prop it into place, and lean it against the house.
Not bad so far.
Yeah, I'm interested.
The front door busted in from outside. The sparse flames flare up in the sudden rush of oxygen. The house has clearly seen its share of squatters, but no semblance of home to it.
Three firefighters enter. Two carry axes, and one has the hose.
From inside the empty bedroom, we see a firefighter on a ladder outside, smashes the window with the butt of his axe. The flames in the room rush when hit with the air. The
first firefighter climbs through the window, mindful of the glass shards.
His feet hit the floor and he scans the room, stops, focuses on something confused.
Chief, you're going to want to come see this.
Wow, people are watching. Hey, whoever's watching, feel free to comment.
Hey, people.
In the center of a bare room sits Roy, mid-30s, thin, pale, and sickly looking. He wears a scuba mask, very similar to the firefighters. He's alive, conscious, but eerily still.
Close up on Roy's mask, reflection of the flames in the glass, underneath, a look of euphoria.
Chief? Chief? Title card.
Eyes on fire.
I like it so far.
Yeah.
Do you think it's too much description?
I wouldn't be unhappy if it was a little bit less.
I think it could be a little bit less, but it's not killing me.
It seems well-researched.
Yeah.
That's an important thing. Roy, sleeping, handcuffed to the bed frame, hooked to an IV, bandages decorate his arms, a band-aid rests on his forehead.
Sunlight through the nearby curtains bathes the linoleum floor with a bright white glow. Roy slowly starts to come to.
He tries to rub his eyes, but the cuffs cease his reach. So this is a little purple now. He snaps awake, and upon realizing the situation, panics.
He flops around in bed, jangles the cuffs against the frame, trying to break loose.
Hey! Hey! What is this? Nurse! Nurse!
Finally, a male nurse, mid-30s, rushes into the room. It's alright, sir. Just calm down.
The male nurse holds Roy's shoulders in and hovers over him. Where am I?
Roy is breathing, heavy, sweating nervously, coughs. You're at St. Joseph's Hospital. You were in a fire last night, and you passed out, so we have you held for overnight observation.
The male nurse rests a hand on Roy's chest to ease him. Roy darts his hand into the cuffs. He is not at ease. This is overly choreographed.
Yeah.
Then what the hell are these for, huh?
Oh, well that's... Let me go get them.
The nurse walks to the door, cracks it, opens, leans out.
Officers, he's awake now.
Two plainclothes detectives, Desmond, mid-30s, and Carlos, mid-40s, enter the room. Do you want to be Desmond or Carlos?
I'll be Desmond.
All right, let's see what's going on in the chat room. Nothing, but someone is watching. Fascinating. Desmond.
Thank you, nurse.
The male nurse shoots Desmond an insulted look. Why is he insulted?
Yeah, I don't know why he's insulted. He said it in a douchey way, but I didn't get that from the dialogue. It just says, to the nurse, thank you, nurse.
Good morning, Mr. Campina.
Lifts his hands, jangles his cuffs.
If you say so.
They both pull out badges, slash them at Roy and pocket them. I'm Detective Rollins. This is Detective Brains.
They hover over Roy. Pulls that notepad.
We'll make this quick so you can get some rest, but we're going to have to ask you more questions down at the station once they let you out of here.
I'm not saying a damn thing till my lawyer gets here.
The detectives share a look.
You got a lawyer? That's right. And if I'm supposed to be in custody, it means I get to make a phone call. So either give me a phone or get out of my room.
Whoa, easy with the attitude, Mr. Champina. We just want to talk.
Yeah. You think I don't know what that means? I'm not stupid.
Carlos flips through Roy's chart, hones in on something.
Why were you sitting in the middle of a flaming room wearing a scuba mask?
He He's an arson. And he's super sexually attracted to fire.
Maybe.
Sounds pretty stupid to me.
Especially considering your condition of possibly being an arson who's sexually attracted. Oh, you mean my cancer? I already told you what I meant, and I already know I'm not saying another fucking word to my fucking Aloy.
Roy starts coughing mid-sentence. He tries to continue, but the cough overtakes him. It's a dry, tight, and wheezy cough. He can't control it.
Desmond grabs a glass of water from his bedside table, quickly fills it with water, and leans over to Roy, tips in his mouth for him.
Roy drinks between coughs, splashing water into the cup. The coughs finally subside. He nods at Desmond, who pulls the glass away.
Thank you.
Desmond sits the glass back on the table, notices a shock of inky red floating floating near the bottom. Bloody backwash.
I feel that was unclear. I mean, if the fact that he drinks and blood comes in the glass, there is probably a more straightforward way to put that.
Yeah.
Hayden rushes into the room. Who the fuck is Hayden?
Ah. Hayden Christensen's here.
No, now I'm mad.
They've never mentioned a Hayden.
Yeah.
Maybe they did and I missed it. I don't know. I can scroll up and we can see if we're both.
All right.
Blind.
Is there a Hayden? No!
That's the first time you see it?
Yeah, apparently he's a big character, though, because he appears 391 times, but still.
Well, it should just be in all caps.
Obviously, yeah.
The first time, yeah. Gentlemen, I'll have to ask you to give my client and I the room, please.
You're his lawyer?
That's right.
How'd you know he was here? He was just demanding that we let you call him.
Awkward moment of tension between the four men. Roy shoots Hayden a worried glance. He quickly recovers. I always know where my clients are.
The cops change suspicious look.
Now please, give us the room.
Hayden unslings shoulder bag and unclips it, rifles through it.
Fine, but this isn't over. Come on.
The detectives take their time walking out the door. Hayden looks up from the bag, watches as Carlos closes the door gently behind him. Alright, we're almost on page 10. From a distance, we see a crew of firemen wash down the engine from last night's blaze. We can't hear what they're saying over the blasting hose, but they're laughing and having fun.
Fire things.
What a good fire.
Hoses.
Avery sits alone at the head of the long table in the massive kitchen, stares blankly at a steaming cup of coffee.
After a long beat, a young fire cadet named Gary swings open the kitchen door and heads for a nearby cabinet. Hey, Chief.
Avery doesn't look up. He's deep in thought. Gary rummages around in the cabinet, gets a loaf of bread and a jar of peanut butter, and stuff happens. More stuff is happening.
Yeah, I feel like it's very, very detailed description when it's not necessary. Like, the first scene, I can see why it was, because it's like an exciting fire scene, but we don't need to hear about him getting the peanut butter out of the cupboard and putting it on the bread and then getting his coffee.
Well, no, hang on. You left out, he takes the bread out of the bag and then, like, puts a knife in the jar, then uses the knife to lift condiment out of the jar, then using the transference point of the knife, leverages the condiment onto the bread and spreads.
I thought he was going to double dip, but he didn't. It really had me hanging there. The mug's not that funny, Chief.
No response.
Chief? Chief!
Finally,
Avery snaps out of it, like waking from a nap. What are you staring at your mug for? It ain't that funny.
Yeah, it so ain't that funny. It really doesn't deserve to be a half a page of your first end. Sorry, I must have drifted off.
I'm making a PB&J. You want one?
Let's talk more about this PB&J. Oh my god, it keeps going. Anyway, after the sandwich choreography is done.
Want to tell me what's on your mind, sir?
Nothing. It's just, we're not reading any more sandwich shit.
Yeah, no, mention of the sandwich and I'm out of here.
After that fire last night, something's been bothering me.
Gary cuts a sandwich now. Okay. What, that guy in the mask? He's a whack job. We see people like that all the time.
No, not this guy. There was something else going on there. We're not.
The sandwich! What? The inner cut of the sandwich action is really making the script for me.
Alright.
Like what?
Avery, looking at Gary's sandwich. I can't place it. He just wasn't that scared at all. You notice? The flames were all around him and he seemed totally at peace. That's weird, right? Like you talking about a sandwich so much.
It's not weird. We run into burning buildings for a living.
Avery drinks that in while looking at Gary's sandwich. I guess you're right. I didn't even know anymore.
20 years on the job and you're still this fucked up? I'm gonna go home and update my resume and make another sandwich.
I wouldn't do that if I were you. In addition to the sandwiches that you like to eat so much, there's gonna be another opening at the head of the table in just a few months, so you may want to go ahead and get in line while eating a sandwich.
Bullshit! This is a great sandwich. How many times have I heard that before?
Avery takes a long sip from his coffee mug, sets it down next to Gary's sandwich. Close up. A tall white man with a tall white mug with tan coffee lines on. Oh, wow.
Oh, let's describe some coffee.
Okay, so the thing where he said, Chief, the mug's not that funny, is moved down here.
A cartoon Dalmatian lifting its leg to piss on a fire hydrant. The hydrant has a cartoon face and a frown and a word bubble that just reads Mondays.
Okay.
Yeah, I feel like they... I just assumed that they had shown the coffee and described it and I'd missed it, but that's
how could you, how could you miss it? You've read every line.
I know, I don't know. Thought maybe it was in one of the sandwich lines that we couldn't deal with. That's funny. Yeah, that should definitely be early on or just not there.
Yeah, like, I don't think that we need three mentions of, you know, Rose, the mug's not that funny. No, the mug's not that funny. Hey, Rose, the mug. It's...
I feel like they're just trying to tie in some products that they can sell when this movie blows up. They're like, you can buy the actual mug that's not that funny from the movie.
Roy, cuffed hands, resting on a table. What? Roy, cuffed hands, resting on a table near a paper coffee cup, sits next to Hayden. On the table is more choreography. Here we go again, Mr. Campina.
Here we go again, indeed. Were these really necessary?
Afraid so. Now let's pick up where we left off at the hospital.
I'm sorry to interject, officers, but is my client being charged with anything here?
Not officially, no, but he is a subject in an ongoing larceny investigation. Now please, let us continue. Mr. Campina, do you mind telling us exactly what it is you were doing at the scene of the fire last night?
You read the report? You said it yourself.
I read it cover to cover twice, and it still doesn't make any goddamn sense. Now answer the goddamn question. What were you doing at the fire last night?
Roy looks at Hayden for approval. Hayden nods. Roy turns and looks at Carlos. Then Desmond smirks. I was sitting down.
Hayden looks at Desmond. Then Desmond looks at Carlos. Then Carlos looks back at Roy. The cycle continues. They react to that information.
Hayden looks at a sandwich.
The remnants of the previous night, charred rubble crumbling down around the foundation. Okay. SUV parks outside. Avery turns, walks up to the what's left of the house. Avery returns to the house, curious.
Huh.
Meanwhile, back at the interrogation room, Desmond gets into Roy's face. Listen, smartass, I've put away guys for a long time for what much less than what you did. My partner's got a list of unsolved arson cases as long as my dick, and so far we got no one to pin them on. All I need is one shred of evidence to make you go away just like that.
Desmond snaps right in Roy's face. He's unfazed. Let me get this straight. Are you really suggesting that a guy with lung cancer is responsible for not just one, but multiple house fires? I'm sorry, Detective, but that's just plain silly.
He's got lung cancer, not missing three arms.
Yeah. So wait, going back to the log line, Roy has a partner who also has cancer? Wasn't the log line a childhood friend with a partner with cancer? Oh, or have we not met the childhood friend yet?
No, remember, it's a detective who plays... It's a fireman who plays detective. So when a firefighter plays detective to investigate a series of arsons, he has to go talk to a childhood friend and a former partner with cancer. So I believe Avery is the guy who's playing detective.
Got it.
How are you feeling about this group so far?
I don't think it's terrible, but the descriptions are just getting more and more ridiculous. Like, I think if we just act like half of them, it wouldn't be too bad. What are your thoughts? I mean, I'm kind of interested, but I'm also... I don't know, it's a little cheesy, like the dialogue thus far.
Hey, I got a list of dialogue issues as long as my dish.
Yeah.
Alright, let's see how minimally we can read these scene descriptions, because they are not fun. So I'm silly now, is that it? I'm not the one who's sitting in the middle of the fire. And where did you get that goofy-ass mask from, huh?
That's out of line, Detective. As you are both well aware, my client has stage 2 lung cancer and uses oxygen to help him breathe. Let's try to be a little more sensitive here, unless we need to escalate this to your superiors. Again.
Unbelievable. Carlos does some business. Mr. Campina, what can you tell us about the night of the fire? Meanwhile, Avery is looking around the house, and he he's looking for clues, and Roy's voiceover carries over that.
Mm, I remember brushing my teeth and curling up in bed with a good book. Next thing I know, I'm waking up in cuffs here in these snazzy digs.
Meanwhile, Avery's crouching down, setting the crumbled floorboards. Okay, so more stuff is going on. Okay, I don't care what these guys are talking about right now.
Yeah.
Avery gets scared by a homeless man.
You gotta recycle those.
Avery spins around, notices a homeless man, 50s, in a coat with burn marks in the lining.
Whoa, man, don't shoot. Don't. It's okay, just looking for some change. Just a little change.
He shoots a skeptical look.
For a hot meal. Hot meal. Hey, at least he's not talking about a sandwich.
I feel like this is not realistic homeless guy dialogue.
No.
Were you here last night?
Homeless man nods back, closely eyeing Avery's pocket.
Good. Breakfast is on me, if you can tell me what happened here.
Avery plops onto the folded couch into the homeless man's palm. He launches into a rant that's barely comprehensible. The man with the eyes. His eyes, fire. Eyes on fire. Kicked me out of my own home, my home. Said he was going to kindle us all. That's what he said he was going to do. Kindle us all. Okay.
This reads like bad Lovecraft dialogue. Stephen King in On Writing has this famous example of how Lovecraft, for all of his gifts as a writer, couldn't write dialogue for shit. Like, in a million words of dialogue, he might have written, or a million words of prose. He might have written, like, maybe a couple hundred lines of dialogue.
Sweet.
And it'd be like, the farmer died. I saw the mist. Twart like any strange living thing. You could tell by the way the mist moved. It was for some place where things ain't as they are here.
Yeah. I mean, we've been around some homeless people here in L.A., and that was very dramatic.
They don't really talk like that.
Nah.
More like, yo, man, you got a cigarette?
Yeah.
Right. But they don't be like, yo, man, got a cigarette? Need to put some smoke in my lungs, where the smoke burns.
Yeah. This is a very poetic homeless man.
Sometimes dialogue is described as overwrought, and this is really tiptoeing with that fine line. Oh, 4 people are watching. Thanks for watching, people.
Hey, guys. It's kind of reading a little soap opera-y.
You just have that in your mind because you've been auditioning. So anyway, Desmond and Carlos are still reacting to this. I can't believe this. Are we really letting this asshole walk?
We don't have enough to hold him here, so we have to. He says he doesn't remember how he got there, and we can't prove that he did anything wrong.
My ass. Wow, look, now they've gone from choreographing sandwiches to choreographing coffee cups.
Carlos scrunches up his face at his coffee. This is cold.
Matt reacts to that while moving a marker on his table. Rose laughs, and Matt moves the marker further.
Why was that necessary? Why do we have to know the coffee was cold? Why did Desmond just say my ass?
All right, here's what's going on here. This is 99 pages, which means this is a script where every line of dialogue is necessary to pad at length.
It's 99 pages. Yeah. I feel like maybe there's just not enough story, and it wasn't long enough, so he's like, I'm just going to add some more description and witty lines, but it's just like, what's not.
So anyway, they talk about stuff, Avery shows up. Detectives?
Chief Davis.
Why is that Bolden? They all shake
Chief
hands.
Chief Davis! How'd it go this morning? Got anything for us?
I got a few empty gas cans stashed under the sink, so I think we can narrow down our cause.
That's great. We'll send forensics down there right now to run prints. Anything else?
Well, I've also got a witness.
Carlos and Desmond look all around and see nobody. A ghost witness?
Worse. Homeless guy.
The detectives roll their eyes.
He was rambling about a man starting a fire, though. It might be something worth looking into.
And you didn't think to bring him in? No wonder you're just a spark stomper.
He's eating breakfast, or at least that's what he told me he was going to go do. Said he'd hang around the scene until someone showed up.
Looks like a wild cock chase to me. Desmond pats Carlos on the shoulder.
Better get to chasing then.
Carlos does not look happy. Desmond shoots him an impatient look. Carlos pounces.
Okay, so Morcraft is going. Okay, what?
It's just like not necessary information.
So finally, Carlos goes and lets Roy out of the interrogation room.
Mm-hmm.
Avery tells good luck. Okay. I love how Avery, who's investigating this crime for Sirius, has just left the homeless guy there. And the unreliable drug addict old man who talks in crazy lyrical prose.
Hey.
He said he'd tinder us all. Tinder us all.
Yeah, he's definitely getting breakfast at Denny's. Getting the Grand Slam right now.
Like, I don't believe that this homeless guy would stick around, nor do I believe that Avery would think that this homeless guy would stick
well,
around.
Well, he's just making Avery sound like a real dumbass, and the cops are, like, calling him out on it, but they're right.
Well, yeah, I...
Unless he's supposed to be kind of like a...
What is his thought process? Now, homeless man, I'm going to leave you here with $10, and I'm going to come back with police officers who are going to hassle you.
Yeah.
So, I might be back in 10 minutes, I might be back in 2 hours, but I'm really counting on you for the civic good of this city to stand right in the scene, homeless drug-addled man.
Yeah.
Can you do that for me? Can you do that for me?
Makes sense.
I will go and talk to my cop brothers now. They'll be proud of me.
Gonna give me a high five.
Okay, so...
That's why he's just a spark stomper.
Ugh. The mug's not that funny, Chief.
Not that funny!
So, they leave. Hayden and Roy are at the door. Oh, here's one. Avery takes a long scan of the station back to them. Hayden recognizes him.
Avery?
Oh my god, Hayden.
They hug. Obviously very familiar with each other.
That's needless information right there. Thanks for filling that one in. Roy stands between him, silent and brooding. What a coincidence running into you here.
Of all places, what are you doing here?
Official police business.
Huh. Good for you. Roy coughs slightly, drawing their attention. Oh, Avery, this is my client, Roy. Roy, this is my good friend, Avery.
Roy sends a hand, hating this, but putting on a brave face. Pleasure.
I have cancer. All right, I'll let you two catch up.
That is so great.
Oh, man.
First.
I'll be in the car.
What do you think of the script so far?
It's going south. It started out pretty good, and now I'm not sure.
I have diabetes.
I'm a little confused about what's happening right now.
All right. Shuffles past out of frame.
So Hayden and Roy are arsons together, and Avery is going to find that out, and it's going to be shitty because it's his childhood friend.
I guess.
Okay. Don't mind him. He's moody.
Clearly. So how is everything?
Good. Things are good. Just getting my practice up and running, taking on any job I can, you know? How about you?
Things are things. I'm retiring in a few weeks.
Good for you. You should come over for dinner to celebrate. Susan and Amy miss you.
Oh, right. How is little Amy? Walking yet?
Walking. Avery, she's 4.
But holy shit. Has it been that long? Man. Time flies.
They duck and dodge around a group of police escorting a prisoner. You're telling me. What about you? Pop out any little firebugs since I last saw you?
Nah, I don't think that's meant for me. This job is kind of all-consuming, and I'm getting on in years. If it was going to happen, it would happen by now.
Hey, it's never too late, right?
The way I see it, I got a firehouse full of guys I need to raise and babysit. That's more than enough.
I'm sure.
They reached its door.
Well, look, I gotta run, but I'm serious about that dinner. We'll be in touch, yeah?
Sure thing. Hayden rushes off. Avery looks on, clearly troubled by something, an uneasy feeling.
After a beat, he turns and gives a last longing look at the police station. Sadness creeps across his face, like he's looking at a life unlived. If he only had some little tots at home. Okay, now I'm getting total Lifetime movie vibes from this.
It's so purple.
I mean, there's a market for cheesy Lifetime movies, I guess, but hot damn.
All right, so we are, 21 pages out of 99. Let's see if we can go 4 more pages, and then we can say we got to the end of the first act.
Okay.
We're going to kind of recap, and then we're going to recap and talk about what we've actually gotten from this. Hayden struts toward his car, moving with a purpose. He's also uneasy about his interaction with Hayden. Looks like he's just got with his hand caught in the cookie jar. Roy smokes against the passenger side of the car.
Really?
So anyway, Hayden buckles his seatbelt. Okay, so a lot of stuff is going on here. Lieutenant Roy, who noticeably leaves his seatbelt unbuckled. I actually don't mind that, because that's an interesting character detail, because he's got cancer. What does he care about dying in?
Yeah. Or they're about to get into a car accident.
We didn't start the fire. Blazer and the... Roy turns his head and looks away at Hayden.
Hello.
Really? So they're an odd couple.
Yeah.
From a Larson pair.
The best kind.
Wait a minute.
Avery and Trevor.
Who the fuck is Trevor?
Laying half naked and facing each other. Okay, that was a weird wild card that I didn't see coming, at least.
I guess, alright.
But yeah, capitalize Trevor, because he's a new character.
Who the fuck is Trevor?
It's the first time you see him.
Okay, so Avery is gay.
Okay. Look into each other's eyes lovingly, no words, no movement, just enjoying each other in peaceful stillness.
Avery reaches out with a hand and gently caresses Trevor's cheek. He responds in kind, running a hand up Avery's arm to his shoulder and neck, through his hair. They kiss.
A shrill beep in the distance, followed closely by another. And another, the smoke detector.
Avery breaks their embrace and scrunches up his face, annoyed.
What the hell, Trevor?
What?
I told you to fix the damn thing weeks ago. Or at least let me do it. It's kind of my job, after all.
I got it!
God.
Ugh.
It's a hazard, you know?
Yeah.
Avery on his back, staring at the ceiling, the muffled sounds of fumbling and clinking.
Trevor walks back in. Okay, Smokey the Bear, where were we?
They kiss again, this time with more passion. All right, well, okay. Trevor is in the mix now. I feel like they're going to, like, lock up Trevor in a flaming house at the end, and Avery's going to have to get him out.
No pun intended. Avery, not wearing his usual uniform, runs up the long steps to the police station entrance, not as chipper as when he was running to burning buildings. Desmond and Carlos walk out of the station. They spot the fire chief.
Turn around.
What?
Walk with this asshole. Just three pals getting some air. Got me coffee.
Did you follow up on my lead?
Your lead? A lunatic hobo is not a lead. Hardly.
Just tell me what you got. I'm sure you didn't drag me down here for nothing.
Listen, pal, we're doing you a favor. We don't have shit because that asshole lawyer of his threatened the department with another discrimination lawsuit.
We're on a short leash again. Wait, so you didn't even follow up on anything? I'm telling you, the guy did it. Roy Campagna, whatever, burned down that house.
Roy Campagna, creepy wheeze, questionable circumstances, fucking scuba mask and all is off limits.
We're not even supposed to be seen with you. Is that why you dragged me down here without my uniform? To embarrass me? I'm trying to work with you assholes. Forget red and blue. We're on the same team. Stop more fire. Save more lives.
Aw, is it chilly without your cape? Stop trying to be a hero. There's nothing to do here. Shit burns. You put it out. Job done.
Look, Chief. Your hobo was a bitch to find. But he's not exactly reliable. Wow, they went to look for him. And he was there.
Mm-hmm.
Turns out he's got a record. And with no one else around to corroborate his story, the thing will fall apart in court.
I mean, that wasn't even a story. It was just like, fire, fire, kindle burning.
Excuse me, can you corroborate that?
You know who did this. Help me prove it.
A young reporter, Oliver Mint, 24.
He sounds real preppy.
He's mint like money. Interrupts the men's conversation. He's holding a voice recorder, red light blinking. Detective Oliver Mint with the Chicago Tribune. Would you care to comment on the recent allegations that...
Stop right there, kid. No, I would not care to comment, and I'd appreciate a little privacy in this trying time, okay?
I understand that, sir, but...
No butts, jerk off, no scram.
Shoves him away, and he looks dejected as they continue walking. What was that about?
Avery froze his brow, confused, and a little scared of the sight of Carlos.
What was that all about?
Nothing, police business.
So anyway, Roy is shopping. He buys rope, a hook, gas cans, and duct tape. He's got a big weekend, man.
Making meth? I don't know.
Coming up the other side of the other direction, Avery and Trevor holding hands, looking very cute together.
Roy coughs, a little blood in his palm that he wipes on his pant leg. He wipes his mouth and his sleeve as he spots Avery down the aisle who hasn't seen Roy yet.
You didn't have to come down here, you know. I could have picked this out myself.
Trevor has a brand new smoke alarm in his free hand. I know, but I wanted to make sure it got done. Trying to get used to the civilian life. It's weird.
Just think, one more day, then you're all mine. No more fires.
Trevor gives Avery a loving peck on the cheek. Avery spots Roy and backs away quickly. Gory points at Avery. Avery tilts his head to the side, a moment of recognition.
You're Avery, right? Hayden's friend?
That's right. And you remind me of your name again?
Roy.
Right. Good to see you.
Likewise. More small talk. So, oh, and by the way, Trevor, this is Roy. He's one of Hayden's clients. And Roy, this is my friend, Trevor.
Trevor extends a polite hand. Roy shakes it.
Pleased to meet you, Roy. Okay, so we...
Just in case everyone was confused about who everyone was up to this point, we just re-clarified it for the audience.
Okay, I'm just about done.
When did we get to the end of the first act?
That was the end of the first act.
Okay, well.
So what do we got on the table here? We got...
We got two sets of people with secret lives.
All right, so if we have to encapsulate it, it's firefighters put out a burning building and find a mysterious arsonist in a scuba mask.
Mm-hmm.
The arsonist is arrested. He's creepy. Oh, no, no, wait. There's a mysterious caller, too, who I completely forgot about.
Mysterious caller?
I'm the mysterious caller. I like burning things.
Oh, yeah. I forgot about that. Yeah, that was nailing it.
So a mysterious caller calls the fire department, and then the fire department comes to put out a fire, catches an arsonist. The cops interrogate him. Meanwhile, the police, or the fire captain, Avery, pokes around in the ashes and finds a homeless guy, goes to the police department, but the police are not very nice to him. And then he discovers that his old friend is a sleazy lawyer representing the obviously creepy Roy.
Yes. Bane with cancer. He likes fires.
Was this really worth 26 pages?
You know, I really did like that first couple of pages, but then things got, you know, a little bit... I mean, once we got to that sandwich stuff, things just really spiraled downhill.
Where do you think this is going?
Like, if I had to predict where the story would go?
Yeah.
Well, I feel like Roy and Trevor... Or, sorry, what's his name? Avery and Trevor
okay,
don't want
still
to...
Still talking about the smoke detector.
Yeah, we should just definitely stay on that subject for a while. It's really intriguing.
All right.
I feel like they don't want people to know that they're gay, so maybe, like, Roy and his little lawyer buddy will find that out and try to use it against them.
He's retiring. What the fuck does he care?
Yeah, I don't know why it's a big deal.
And also, it's, like, 2016.
Yeah. And then...
Alright, tight on the terrified and bloody face of a drug dealer. Mid-20s, sideways and pressed against the floor. His screams and cries for help are muffled by duct tape. Tied to a chair, Roy stands behind him wearing his trademark scuba mask. Oh, do you know what? I do kind of see, like... The way it's introduced is kind of goofy, but I guess he's wearing, like, kind of like a Halloween mask. Kind of like, you know, that's his trademark.
Yeah.
Roy stands... Okay, more... So he's torturing this drug dealer with gasoline, and then he lights it.
Maybe he's one of those Saw-type Dexter killers who only kills people who are bad.
Or like the Joker.
Yeah.
It all starts with a spark, an idea, a simple blinking moment in time that forever changes the future. Maybe it's a lit cigarette in the trash can. Maybe it's a candle kissing the wind-blown drape. Maybe the flame of a lighter embraced by the flames and fumes of gasoline. Doesn't matter. Something sparks it, sets in motion. Roy holds the flaming book up to eye level with the drug dealer, and if you let it, it will destroy everything in its path, everything it touches until the end of time. Wow.
Okay, this monologue is going for it right now.
I fought that idea, that spark. For 20 years, I snuffed out that potential every day I put on this uniform. Who is he talking to?
It's being dramatic.
Wow, it's still going.
Yep. Exterior crack ass.
And he snuffs out the possibility again.
You gotta snuff out the possibilities.
My purpose in life was to squander the beautiful potential of such visceral destruction. Is that heroic? 20 years is a long time. The longest I've ever done anything in my life. Except this monologue. Okay. Begrudgingly. Okay, he's still talking off camera. The flames reflected in the car's front windshield.
All clear? What's in the trunk?
Donations. Wow, so Avery, pre-lap.
Still going. I guess what I'm trying to say.
Okay, so we cut to reveal that in the firehouse, Avery has been doing this entire speech to his fire crew, who've been listening respectfully. Anyways, cheers, guys.
Hail to the chief.
War of
Hail to the chief.
Avery sips from his glass and his crew all sips from their drinks. One is sipping from a highball. Another sips Chardonnay from a stemless glass. Another sips red wine from a glass with a stem. Another sips a whiskey sour from a highboy glass. Another has a lowboy glass.
Oh, boy.
A third sips malt liquor from a jelly jar. We hear the sounds of a handful of boys lightly horsing around, laughing as we descend a smoky trail from the clear night sky to a burgeoning camp flame.
Lightly horsing around is just a very weird term to me.
I wonder if the flame is from the campsite or is just like vaguely gay.
Yeah, it could be.
One boy is crouched closer to the other, tending to the sticks.
That's a fine fire, Avery. Well done keeping it contained.
Oh, it's a flashback.
Yeah.
A young Avery. Okay.
Why is this happening right now?
Has any camp counselor ever told you a good job keeping that camp contained?
Nah. That's
It's a little on the nose. You know, young Avery, maybe you should contain fires for a living. Some sort of fire container man, or someone who struggles with fires. I struggle for the correct terminology, but maybe you have a career in the fire containment service.
Hey, we all have had that mentor that has set us off under our future career path.
Okay. So we see the kids as kids, and... Oh, you're acting like a jerk again.
You're just sour you lost to cops and robbers, again.
Metaphor. I'll catch you next time.
Not if I catch you first.
The voice chuckle. Not even a toasty marshmallow will cover up the stink of your guilty paws, robber.
Hayden stuffs the cold marshmallow into his mouth.
Your prints are all over this mess.
Prove it.
Add to a roaring campfire. Enjoy that story, Hayden? You wanted a real scary one, right, Hayden? Cut to you. Hayden stands in front of the stove, staring down. So I guess we're in present times now?
Yeah, don't you think when there's a flashback, it should just say cut to you flashback? Just
yeah,
so you
or
clear,
italicize
then,
it or anything.
Yeah, something to differentiate it.
Okay, I can already tell this is going off the rails, and here's why. A lot of times when you're doing a script, you want to set up something like cops and robbers. Here's the robber, here's the cop, they're going to fight. And, like, they're going to... The duel between the cop and the robber is going to come up with a bunch of fun set pieces.
Mm-hmm.
And you're going to have a second act where... Sequence one, a gunfight in a marketplace. Sequence two, a car chase in the hills of San Francisco. Sequence three, you know, a cat and mouse game in an aquarium.
Mm-hmm.
Sequence four, breaking into the robber's house while, you know, terrorists have a cocktail party there. So, ideally, your premise should have enough sequences or set pieces to populate an entire second act.
Yeah.
But when you gotta go into, all right, in 100 pages, we gotta spend 6 pages in flashback. So, that, rather than have the cop chase the robber, the writer hasn't thought of enough cop-robber stuff, so he's gotta pad out the second act, thinking, oh, yeah, so now we cut to his childhood. Oh, now maybe he can have a bad dream. Oh, and now maybe a subplot where his kid gets stuck in a freezer.
Yeah.
So he's doing everything but examining the core dilemma. So this is a script where it's written in a cunning way to obfuscate a lack of content.
Yeah, that's what it seems like. Because that flashback wasn't even, I don't feel like we didn't really learn that much about either character, except like somebody was like, hey, you should be a firefighter, kid, and then Hayden gets like pissed off
yeah.
easily.
And
like,
I'm winning at cops and robbers, because that's the metaphor.
Yeah. But I'll get him next time.
Mm-hmm. I wonder if, I almost want to cut ahead to the last act to see if that.
Should we do that? Let's do it.
So Hayden and Avery are talking. Oh, so they're having their dinner.
Dinner with the kids.
Hayden is married to someone named Susan. All right. So let's just do this scene. Avery reaches for the plate, hands a stack to Susan.
My hero.
They exchange a friendly smile. Hayden pops a noodle in his mouth, chews it, and shakes his head. It's done. Well, grabbing plates is a little less scary than snatching cats out of burning buildings.
Well, still.
She sits at the table. More choreography. Yay.
Oh, speaking of, have you been keeping up with all these random house fires? It's been all over the news.
Yeah, I've been hearing things.
The news is saying there's a serial arsonist out there, and just last week they burned down a crack house over on Shattuck Avenue, and somebody was killed.
We know. So,
this next line.
Hayden's expression changes. New information. He's furious, terrified. Smoke detector goes off. Shit! The garlic bread!
Oh, man.
It's so loud. Beeping continues.
I'm waving the towel at it, and it's not working.
Damn, it's cold.
Language!
Sorry, honey! Avery looks around, still lost in the shuffle. Finally, the beeping stops. Susan marches down back to the kitchen, looking flustered.
That stupid thing is on the fritz again.
Alright, this is a very long scene.
Well, I mean, there doesn't seem to be much point to it, except that she's talking about the
arsonist. She restated information.
Yeah, I mean, we don't need to restate that.
It's the living room equivalent of cutting to a newscaster commenting on what's going on, which is another filler trick. If you're ever using too many dream sequences, flashbacks, or newscasts commenting on the action, that's usually a sign that you know in your heart you don't have enough for a second act, and you're faking it. So this table scene continues. Then Avery goes to visit a dollhouse. I'm sure you will, sweetie. He points to a dog figure in the tiny porch. What's that little guy's name?
That's Dusty. He's silly. And that's Roy. I named him after my uncle.
Oh.
Finally some good information.
Your uncle? I thought I was your uncle.
My other uncle. He's sick, so my daddy likes to take him for car rides at night. He says the fresh air makes him feel better.
Okay, for starters, Avery's the dumbest cop in the world because this little girl just broke the case. And
yeah, can't you just do like a background report of somebody and see that they're related somehow?
Well, that's more than this. Like, if I was like trying to investigate a case and Amy says, and that's right, and I'm never, and after my uncle, your next line should be, go on, not, I thought I was your uncle. Like, why are you getting a joke in there? You are literally.
Why is he jokingly insulted?
What do they do together? Wait a minute. Flashback. What else did they do together? A set of cadets pass on a lap of a small but tidy building that looks like an old school gym renovated ages ago. We move up the short flight of stairs to the main entrance. Mr. Roy Campina, how many times have I seen you this year?
Four, sir.
What time period are we in? So this is a flashback, too?
I think so, but that wasn't clear at all.
Okay. Oh.
How are we supposed to know that?
Okay,
Matt, don't have an aneurysm. We got some fundamental problems here.
These are fundamental problems. This is why it frustrates me when people say the only way to learn screenwriting is to read scripts or something. Because there are problems here that are not easily fixable.
Yeah.
All right.
I mean, how would you... I mean, I think the main things that are fixable are cutting a shit ton of the descriptions and then just making it more clear when it's a flashback. I don't know, we need the flashbacks. It's also a little strange that they're just showing up in the second act, but don't you think if that's something that's used, it should be more evenly spread out throughout the script?
Yeah, that's a controversial point, but I do believe that flashbacks should have a kind of rhythm to them. Like, there should be a pattern for where they go as opposed to just whenever you need to buy space. The biggest problem with this script is that it's writing around a lack of content.
Mm-hmm.
This could be expressed in a 45-minute anthology series or a 20-minute short film. So why is it a feature?
Yeah. I mean, yeah, I can almost see it working better as a pilot.
Or something. Or,
yeah, just something shorter. That's all the filler.
So if this isn't optimal for a feature, why is it written as a feature? Well, it's because nobody gives a shit about shorts, because shorts don't make you a ton of money and won't hypothetically change your life. So this is a case of what happens when you pad out an idea that isn't quite a feature to something that's feature length, not because you thought it would be more entertaining this way, but because it's more ego satisfying and gets you more money.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have to suffer for it because I'm unwowed. I mean, other than the fire in the beginning, which was interesting,
mm-hmm.
all I've seen is scenes of two cops sniping at each other, a guy walking around in the ashes looking for clues, a crazy homeless guy, and a gay couple shopping for a fire alarm.
Yeah.
And then a dinner sequence. There's no genre. To be fair, we did skip over the genre thing of Roy burning that drug dealer alive.
We did. That was a traumatic moment.
But that wasn't really actively tied to Avery.
Yep.
Because he's not a cop. And it's not really his job.
I mean, I feel like you could turn this into a weird series. Like, if you turned it to a pilot, it could be like, this fireman who always ends up doing more of a cop-type job. Like, he solves a mystery or a crime when the cop, because he's just, like, good at putting pieces together, even though he's just a fireman. Like, you could make that a series, potentially. But I don't think it's working. It's a future. Boy, it is.
Yeah. Also, the dialogue is killing me. Like, the homeless guys sound like some cliche jack chick tract of a cliche.
Yeah, that was weird. I don't know what that was all about.
And the children talk in that, like, overly sincere golden age Superman kind of way. Like, me see ball, me want to run.
Yeah. Yeah, it's pretty rough. All right. Well, should we skip to the very end and see what happens, or are we done with this?
All right. Without any comment, let's skip to page 90. Hayden looks up, a flicker of recognition, a reserved smile. Other night at the bar, some bimbo steal your Zippo? Or is that how fags hit on each other?
Hayden laughs and closes the folder. The sat sense of humor must be why they toss you in the athlete's pit.
Into what?
This room always smells like athlete's foot.
Didn't take your word for it. My nose is kind of shot.
Lucky bastard, I hate this little shithole.
Yeah, I'm done.
Yeah.
All right. Let's look at a short.
Okay. Switch it up.
I'm sad that I read that.
We wanted to give it a chance, and we did. And that's all you can do, Matt.
I feel like the author didn't really care if I had fun or not.
Yeah.
I really feel like the primary concern on the script was making sure it hit 100 pages, and therefore everything was padded out.
That makes it awkward.
Sure, sanity. This is meant to be the possible opening or inciting incident of a falling down type story. I don't intend any of the characters to be sympathetic or likable, but I wanted to... Okay, I don't even understand what this person is saying.
It's just...
Do you?
No.
All right, World War Uber seems amusing.
Yeah.
First crack at a comedy. Does it suck? Is it funny? Are there any format or grammar problems I missed?
Should we give it a look-see?
Well, for starters, it's not how you spell grammar.
That's amazing.
I mean, unless it's a grammar problem, as in you think it might attract the ire of Kelsey Grammer.
I'm trying to be ironic. World War Uber, a six-part odyssey.
Okay.
First one. Okay, I don't know why his email and phone number ended up on the second page, but...
That's probably a title page error. World War Uber, a six-part odyssey. Not tonight, it's not. By, colon, Max Prius. Bruce. Crappy New York apartment, morning. Phil Green, mid-20s. Ugh. That should be hyphenated, shouldn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Lies passed out in his bed after a night of hard drinking. His dog, Rebel, slams into the room and up onto Phil's bed.
God, your breath smells like other dogs' balls.
Burk, burk. Burf, burf, burf. Phil gets out of bed.
Another day, another misery.
Phil walks to his bathroom and starts brushing his teeth. Rebel walks over, leashing mouth.
No, you're not right now. You have to wait till after I pick up the car.
More shit happens.
Eat up. You're going to miss this when we're homeless.
Phil puts a bowl in the sink next to a sandwich. Backpack in hand, pats Reble on the head and goes next to the door. Typo.
He's Spanish now.
Yeah.
Hey, listen. Do your job. Keep this place locked down.
Gox to the side. Seriously?
I'm serious. Oh, and no accidents on the floors. This place is shitty enough. Use the toilet like we talked about.
Phil leaves the apartment and lock it. I'm not sure if that's how dogs work.
Yeah.
Phil heads to the street and starts to hail a taxi. A man next to him types on his phone.
Excuse me?
Yes?
What are you doing?
Calling an Uber. What's it to you?
Why use Uber when you get a taxi?
Taxis are for punk bitches like you.
Good morning.
Soal, a Russian stereotype into life. Where to, Phil?
Hang on. Let's see, can you get me to West and Clarkson Street? What's your name?
I am Soal Zgedman. What is your
How do you do a Russian accent?
In Soviet Russia.
Communist
Party. I am so good. I can't even.
What's your name?
No. Finally, we kill Moose and Squirrel. I am
oh
so Zgedman. Your name?
Philip D. Green. Good to meet you. Still, how long have you been doing this?
About 4 years. You taxi driver too?
No, I haven't started yet. I'm waiting till tomorrow. But wow, look at you. 4 years. You could have graduated from college by now.
What does that have to do with anything?
I'm just saying, you could have gotten a real job if you went to college.
What a dick.
Why is Phil being a real douchepacker?
Oh my god.
What's going on?
You think you're a funny guy, huh? Who says I didn't already go to college?
Calm down, Wadu. Just being sarcastic.
Jesus.
Hell.
Okay. So we are 5 pages into this 30-page work. What's the impression you get from this?
Well, Phil seems like a real dipshit, but I don't know. Maybe...
Why does he defend calling an Uber? Or why does he defend taxi over Uber and then act like a total shitheel to the taxi driver?
It's very confusing.
And what is his job?
And he's about to become a taxi driver. They said he was in his early 20s. Mid-20s?
Yeah.
So maybe he didn't go to college and his life's falling apart, so he's just, like, deflecting on this guy?
Possibly.
I mean, he's not very likable for the main character, but maybe he's supposed to be a total bastard. I don't know.
I'm frustrated. I don't want this to just be the shit on beginner show, because that's not fun.
Yeah.
Let's see if there's something that's actually likable or fun in here. Come on.
Come on, Reddit. The Zany Adventures of Michael Gambon.
Where?
It was like two down.
Is it Michael Gambon, the guy from Harry Potter?
Yeah, the British actor. Russell Dumbledore.
Okay, I'm already having you done.
Yeah, we got it. I mean, we can't just pass that one by.
Zany Adventures of Michael Gambon, by person. We see Michael Gambon sitting opposite of the camera, legs crossed, the camera off screen. I think we should start off with a prank call. I'm going to call my good friend, Gary Oldman.
The phone begins ringing. Michael starts bouncing on the spot, giddy with anticipation. There's a short pause before Gary Oldman starts speaking. Hello?
Is this Mr. Oldman?
Who is this?
I am Mr. Maltridge with your insurance company. I have some bad news to inform you.
It says this number is blocked. Is this Michael? Michael Gambon?
No, this is Mr. Maltridge from the insurance company.
Michael, Maltridge isn't a real name.
I'm just informing you that your car has been towed and you need to pay to get it back.
Michael, I told you to stop calling this number.
Yeah, if you want to pay us as soon as you can, that'll be great.
Michael hangs up. He starts breathing loudly and
heavily. I almost lost it there. I almost lost it.
Michael's trying to sit as casually as possible, or at least what he thinks is casual. He's spread out his arms and legs on the couch as much as he can.
So why did you decide to create this show, Michael?
Why? Well, I guess you'll see why as the season progresses. My life is an adventure, to say the least. Actually, I'll tell you, while I was doing this, I realized I need to make this show. I was washing my dishes, and I had two brands of washing up liquid. And I was tossing and turning on which one to use, and when I had the genius idea of using both at the same time. Yes, at the same time.
So what happened then?
Well, I had to sit down, because, you know, my heart was racing too much. My water went cold, so I had to refill. I just used Persil the next time.
Michael exits his house to walk nonchalantly towards his car. However, he does not acknowledge the lift of the doorway and stumbles, almost falling over.
Cut that! Michael exits his house for a second time like nothing had happened, but clearly avoids the lip of the driveway.
Michael sits at traffic impatiently, tapping on the wheel to the beat of Take On Me by Aha, which is playing on the radio, as well as moving his shoulders to it.
Just nipping off to the shops, picking up some washing up liquid.
You haven't done radio, have you, Michael?
Well, I don't like to talk about it.
Wasn't well received.
Yes, it was. In 1990 it was. I played Jerry in Harold Pinter's Betrayal. He's dead now, though, so...
Michael and the cameraman sit in awkward silence. All of a sudden, the silence is broken. It's Michael's phone. His agent, more specifically.
How do we know that? Can you get the phone for me?
Cameraman picks up the phone and holds it next to Michael's ear.
Give me an earphone. Hello, yes? Of course I'm interested. Oh, on my way. I'm just making a quick detour.
Michael beats the phone out of the cameraman's hand.
So, let's see. They go to the agent's office. Well, what did they say?
Well, they were a bit vague, but,
Did you tell them I played Dumbledore?
Yes, of course.
What about my BAFTAs? Did you mention them?
Well, I tried to mention it.
I've got four. Remember, four BAFTAs.
Listen, Michael, everything is fine. They're offering you one of the main roles. It's just that it doesn't have the best of budgets.
What's this film even called?
Space Hitler.
Space Hitler? What the fuck is Space Hitler? So they're on Jupiter.
Yes.
And the aliens are converting us to Nazism.
Yes.
And where do I come into this?
Once again, you're Space Churchill, and you have to race to Saturn to save...
How much are they planning to pay for this?
Well, they're actually...
You know what? I don't care. I'm one of the most respected actors in England, if not the world. My career is arguably at an all-time high, and I don't need to take an insulting offer like this. I'm Michael Bloody Gambon. And he takes it. Boom. I'm amused by this. Why?
I mean, it would just be really funny if they could actually get him to do it and have all of those guest stars like Gary Oldman on it. I mean, like, that's just good actors being funny. It kind of has a feel like the British Office or, like, all those Ricky Gervais shows.
Like Life's Too Short?
Life's Too Short and Extras. I'd watch it.
Yeah. I like it because it's got a very clear joke. It's, here's a guy who takes himself too seriously, who stereotypically should be very serious and proper.
Yeah.
And is, in fact, a total dipshit.
Yeah.
So I thought that was a clear illustration of a joke, which means we can end on a high note because those other... Oh my god, Eyes on Fire.
Eyes on Fire, baby. That just needs to be a Nick Cage movie. He'd do it. He'd be Avery.
I always want to find a script that like I can read all the way through. We can read all the way through.
Yeah.
And then break it up into episodes. But the thing is, like, a lot of them just... There's no there.
Yeah.
Do you think it's better to... Do you think it's better to just do it as a slog, just... Something we're clearly not enjoying and just, like, stretch it out over a couple episodes? Or...
Well, I feel like the same problems come up over and over again, especially in a script like, what's it called? I blocked it already.
Eyes on Fire?
Eyes on Fire. I was going to say the sandwich movie. So, you could keep reading it, but I feel like we're just going to be making the same comments after a while. I don't know.
Yeah. I wonder what to do with the show to keep it fresh. Like, obviously, there's a non-live version of it that could be edited together. One of the things I was thinking of is possibly a supercut of, like, first 10 pages that don't hit me.
Mm-hmm.
Or, you know, act two breaks that don't work, or filler, or too much choreography.
Mm-hmm. That's a good idea. Do we have any ideas from our viewers? We have 4 watching.
Our very quiet viewers. Well, thank you for watching.
Yeah, thanks for watching, guys.
If you've stuck with it this long, check out www.thestorycoach.net. And from us, we will see you next time.
Bye, guys.